My name is Emily DeBolt. I'm the Director of Education here at the Lake George Association, and I have been running our Lake Steward program for the last two summers, so 2010 will be the third summer running this program here on Lake George, and I'm also going to talk a little bit about the programs on Lake Champlain and in the Adirondacks as well. And I'm fine with questions as we go, so if people have questions or comments, feel free to speak up, please. I think everyone probably knows what invasive species are. So we're dealing with a number of different aquatic invasive species for these boat launch programs, some of which we can see and some of which we can't see as well. And really, we're thinking about the way that these species are moving between our water bodies. So for instance, this map here from the basin program shows that they are actually connected to other water bodies with invasive species. So they have threats to their lake of invasive species spreading by being connected to waterways. But that's not the case for many other lakes, including Lake George and a number of lakes here in the park. You can see this map is from the APIP prism, showing a number of the lakes that have been surveyed in the park, and obviously they're not all connected, at least by navigable waterways. A number of them are connected, but not necessarily through boat traffic, through large water bodies that boats can really go through. So besides being connected, the other thing that is really spreading invasive species, as I think we all know, are boats. And I really like this cartoon by Mark Wilson up at Lake Placid, I believe. And so really the boats are spreading invasive species. So what we are doing about it are some boat launch programs. The first one really in our area was started by Paul Smith College through their Adirondack Watershed Institute. Some of you might be familiar with this program. It's run by Eric Holmland. This is his slide that I'm borrowing. And so they started their watershed stewardship program back in 2000. So they have been going for 10 years now. So they have lots of great experience. They started off just a few lakes right around Paul Smith and then have begun expanding. They don't just do boat launch stewards, though. I believe they have some mountain stewards, and they do some community service and research. So they do a number of things besides just typically the boat launch program with a steward sitting at the launch. But so they have, I think, maybe focused on that more in recent years as that's become more popular and more lake associations are interested in that. And since funding is tight for a lot of people, they have started up a training for volunteer lake stewards. So if there's a lake association out there that doesn't have the funding to maybe pay lake stewards, there is the opportunity to have Paul Smith provide some training for you, and so then you could have a volunteer lake steward program. And that is something that they offer. I know they'll be offering some trainings this summer, so you would want to get in touch with Eric Holmland about that, or you could talk more to myself or Hillary from our prism and get that kind of information. So as I said, Paul Smith does a number of things besides the actual boat launch program with their students. And so now over the years, some other groups such as Lake George here have gotten interested in what they're doing. And so they have really helped kind of pass the torch and expand to some other programs. So they have been working very closely with myself here in Lake George and also with the Lake Champlain Basin Program, which started a lake steward program in 2007, and Meg Mobley runs that program over there on Lake Champlain. So Eric, Meg, and I work pretty closely together with Hillary, our prism leader, to really try to coordinate all of our lake steward program efforts up in this area of the state. When we were starting our programs, we were using the Paul Smith program as a model, but things were a little different. Paul Smith actually has lake stewards at multiple different lakes in the Adirondacks, and they're smaller lakes, and they have fewer access sites. in both Lake George and Lake Champlain. So Meg and I both had some things to think about when we were thinking about developing our own programs in terms of, you know, where our lakes are located, what type of users we're getting. We get some fishermen on Lake George. I know Lake Champlain gets a lot more fishermen. So those are some issues when you have fishing tournaments coming through, the number of different launches you have, public and private on your lake. All of these things are things that are going to affect the ability of invasive species spread and the likeliness of you getting them. So you want to consider these things when you're planning your program. For those of you not too familiar with Lake George, just a quick background. It's a 32-mile-long lake. It's pretty good surface area and pretty deep. So we have some good fishing here. We have salmon and lake trout, which we're very concerned about some specific invasives such as alewife and spiny water flea and their ability to affect our fishery. So we have those concerns as well as typical invasive species concerns in general, like milfoil. However, Lake George is fed by streams. So we're lucky that we have a bunch of small streams feeding us, and we're not really connected to a lot of other water bodies. So we're not getting invasive species in that way. The only way we're really getting them in is on boats. And Lake George actually flows north into Lake Champlain. So we're not getting things from Lake Champlain either, even though we are connected to them because of the way the water flows. In terms of the access sites where invasive species could be entering our lake, we have a few state access sites. On the south end is a public launch, but it actually closes during the summer because it's a beach. So we don't really have a lot of public access on the south end of the lake. There's a campground and a car top launch on the north end, but then there's really only one main public launch on the lake, and it's all the way in Ticonderoga, the Mossy Point boat launch. It's actually less than 5 miles from Lake Champlain, so it's a concern for us when we're thinking about where our invasives might be coming from. We are worried about those boats that might be coming right out of Lake Champlain and then coming over to try the fishing over in Lake George. There are a few public launches also on the small, the north end of the lake in Hague and Gull Bay, and again, those are pretty small launches. And then we do have a number of private marinas. Some of them do a pretty good launch, you know, quantity of boats. Some of them kind of just have their main customers and boats stay in the water. So it's hit or miss in terms of what might or might not be coming out of our private marinas. And we're really focusing our efforts on education there of the marinas and the staff, more so than actual trying to staff them with a lake steward. The invasive species that we have in Lake George, we have milfoil and curly leaf and zebra mussels. And then just this past summer, right towards the end of the summer, one spot of brittle naiad was found near one of the boat launches. So that just added a fourth invasive species for us this past summer. When I say we have milfoil, it's pretty much all over the lake, as you can see from the map here. It's been managed for a number of years. However, at this point, most of the sites are being noted as clear, and there's really only a dozen or so sites that are still really bad beds of milfoil that are going to be managed again this summer. However, as everyone knows, the boats drive through the beds of milfoil, and so that can be a problem with continually spreading it. We don't have a system to keep the boats out of those beds of milfoil at this point. For zebra mussels, Lake George also does have zebra mussels. However, it is not covered in them. They have actually been found at a number of launches and marinas around the lake. But every time they are found, we have some divers from the Darren Freshwater Institute here on Lake George and Bateau Below, a nonprofit group interested in the history of the Bateau wrecks here on the lake. And they actually dive and remove any zebra mussels found. So because Lake George actually has low calcium levels, that is what has limited zebra mussel growth in our lake. So even though they were introduced, they did not take over like they have in many other lakes due to calcium levels in Lake George. So we kind of have a unique situation here in that we have zebra mussels, but we don't actually expect anyone to see them. So every time we find them, we take them out. So that's a little different. I don't have a map of the brittle naiad and curly leaf because the curly leaf hasn't been mapped, but it's pretty much everywhere, I think. And the brittle naiad is just in one spot. It was found at Dunham's Bay, which is on the south end of Lake George, and we're going to be keeping a close eye on that this summer. It was pulled last year when it was found, so we're going to be seeing if any more shows up. So what's knocking at our door here on Lake George? We only have 4 invasive species, but that's plenty. We don't need any more. These are the species that at our prism level we have been keeping an eye out for. Of course, Lake George has the first 3 already, but we most definitely don't need to add the other ones to our list. And the same with other species in the state so far that some of you might have in your lakes that we do not have here in Lake George yet. Also, the non-plants, we have the zebra mussels, of course, but as I mentioned before, alewife and spiny water flea are something we don't want, and they're very close by. Alewife is right in Lake Champlain, and spiny water flea was found in Great Sacandaga Lake, which is just to our west. So we're concerned about both of these species and the rest of the species that we're on the lookout for in New York State as well. So what we can do, or what at least we're doing here on Lake George, about all of these threats of these invasive species arriving in our lake on the boats, is just some spread prevention and education. We created these Clean Boats, Clean Waters stickers that we distribute to help get the word out. I actually found this logo from Sea Grant in, oh gosh, either Michigan or Minnesota maybe. And they were generous enough to share the graphics file with us. So we have this, we created this sticker, and this is kind of the beginning of our campaign. We've now shared this file with a number of other lakes in our area, such as Scroon Lake and Brant Lake. And so they are all getting stickers printed, and they just use the same printer, and they can change the words to say protect Scroon Lake or protect Brant Lake, but so that then the message is consistent and everyone's kind of seeing it. So if anyone else is interested in that, we're more than happy to share the artwork. Or even the printer we work with is great, and they're more than happy to just go in and change the lake name for you. And then it's all set if you're interested in getting these printed off to distribute around wherever you are. With the stickers came our first, the first summer that I covered the Boat Launch Steward program in 2008. I did a lot of research into a lot of other programs in other states. There was a NEANS, the Northeast Aquatic Nuisance Species panel, I think, meeting where a number of people from the different states in the Northeast, I got to learn about some of their programs. Some of them are more voluntary than others. Some of them call them boat access greeters and whatnot. We settled on the name Lake Steward. Very long discussion. I won't get into it, but, you know, you can pick whatever name might work for your lake. And really, we just went with Lake Stewards, and we got going with our stewards working at the marinas throughout the summer. Here are two of our stewards at Norwal, one of the very busy marinas on Lake George. So 2010 will be the third year of us coordinating the program. It's actually the 5th year of a Lake Steward program on Lake George. It was previously coordinated by Dave Decker, who is the director of the Lake George Watershed Coalition, which is where the funding for the program has typically come from. He directed it the first 2 years, and then the Lake George Association has taken it over for the coalition since then. The goals of the program are pretty simple and straightforward, I think. We're really just trying to educate boaters about spread prevention, help prevent new introductions into the lake, and also help the spread of things that we have out of the lake. So we don't forget about that, especially at our Hague launch. The actual launch itself is full of milfoil and curly leaf, and we know some other lakes nearby don't have that, and so we try to clean boats on the way out, too, and make sure that we're not exporting invasives out of our lake, as well as being worried about things coming in. In 2008, we had 4 stewards and covered the 4 main launches. In 2009, we were lucky enough to be able to hire 5 stewards and an assistant coordinator to help me out. And since the stewards are located all around the lake, with the lake being 32 miles long, and it takes about an hour to drive from where I'm down in the village to the Ticonderoga launch at the north end. So we don't get to all see each other every day. What we did was hold biweekly staff meetings, and we were always in constant contact on cell phones to keep up throughout the season. The training was really important, I think, at the beginning to really get the stewards ready for the job. They learned all sorts of information about interacting with the public and interpretation, being comfortable with invasive species identification, and a number of things. We hold the training up at Paul Smith College. Eric has been generous enough to welcome Meg and her stewards and us and our stewards and other lakes as well into the training so we can have a group training, which is really important. There's Hillary. We took the stewards out on a boat last year and actually got some plants up and actually did some real identification right there on the spot, which was great for them. Once they are done with their training in May, we get them ready to start right away at that Memorial Day weekend here on Lake George. And they work in pairs for around the first 2 weeks so that they can get comfortable with interacting with the boaters, filling out the data sheets. And then we split them up so that we can cover more locations around the lake. In 2008, we saw just under 3,000 boats. And in 2009, we actually saw just under 4,000 boats at the different launches around the lake. So you can see in 2008, we tried out some of the smaller marinas, Northwest Bay and Island View, and we were only there a few days, but for the days we were there, we figured it just really wasn't worth our time, the cost of being there and the number of boats we were seeing. So we focused our efforts elsewhere on the other launches that were getting more traffic. And again, in 2009, we wanted to try out another small town launch in Gull Bay, but again, the traffic just really wasn't there for us to justify our time. So those would be launches that would be better maybe for a volunteer situation or signage or something like that. And we focused our efforts at the launches that were receiving more traffic. We compiled the data to see where the boats were coming from. So the stewards asked the boater in the last 2 weeks, what was the last water body that you visited? And you can see I put up here, hopefully you can read this, but I put our results from 2008 and 2009 just to compare, and I kind of tried to star with different colors so you could easily kind of see that, you know, that pretty much the same things were, the same lakes were the top ones for both years, with the Hudson River being the most common for both years, and then Lake Champlain, Saratoga Lake, Lake Hopatcong in New Jersey, which I finally learned to say after it being butchered for the last couple years now. I think I spoke to someone from there and finally found out how to say that one. Great Sacandaga Lake, but so you can see we have a number of the same lakes that it seems like this is where boaters are coming from before putting their boat in at Lake George. And especially you can see Great Sacandaga Lake is on there in both years, and that is the lake that has spiny water flea right nearby that we're very concerned about. So it's interesting to see that we are most definitely getting boats right out of Great Sacandaga Lake. And with how close it is, you know, I'm sure there could be viable spiny water flea on those boats. So that is a real concern for us. We can also look at the data to see where boats were coming from by state. So again, our own state is the most common, but Massachusetts, Connecticut, and New Jersey seem to be the other most common states where boats were coming from in both years. So this can give us an idea of more of a regional look at where boats are coming from and kind of how things might be spreading around from lake to lake regionally by state besides just by specific water body. And then we can also take an even larger look. We can look just at New York State here. We actually talked to Scott Kishbaugh at DC and a number of other people and figured out the best we could which of the lakes we knew had some sort of invasive in it. So out of the 56 water bodies that boats had been in before coming into Lake George in New York State in 2008, 41 of those were infected with some sort of invasive species. The rest either weren't, or we just don't know whether they are or not. And then you can see on the larger map, the last water body boats were coming from. Is you know, pretty diverse. You would expect the northeast dots, I think, but the dots down, you know, Key West, Florida, the Gulf of Mexico, all the way over in Illinois, I think those were a little bit of a surprise for us when we first saw this map that our GIS specialist put together for us with our water body list. Again, in 2009, it was very similar for the New York State numbers. This time, 39 out of 58, we think, were infested bodies, or, you know, bodies that have at least one invasive species in it. And our map got a little thrown off for the whole state. Because we had one from all the way out west, I mean, for the whole United States. So, but again, a good spread there, and boats, you know, coming from the Gulf of Mexico and Tennessee as well. What we found were four main invasive species, and the photos there kind of show that some of the samples are really big, obvious globs. Some of them are just little tiny ones. We do actually find zebra mussels on milfoil. You know, people always, you always kind of see the drawings like that, and I didn't know if it actually happened, and it does. And we found water chestnut as well, which we had historically in Lake George, but we don't currently have. It had been found in Dunham's Bay back in the early 90s and removed, and is not known to be here now. So we had, I guess you could call these saves, you know, around 75 saves the last year, and so a total of, you know, over 100 saves or stopping additional species from coming in. What we also did was looked at our data, and for each boat that had one of the invasive species, we found out the last body of water it was in. So it's a very big disclaimer on this chart at the bottom that this by no means means that the body of water listed there is where the invasive came from, because it could have been on the boat for a while and gone through a number of lakes before we took it off at Lake George. So I just want to clarify that, but it's a possibility that it came from that lake. So that's kind of the best we can do at this point, because we don't really know if it came from that previous water body or not. But we can at least look at this and get some ideas of what lakes kind of keep coming up on the list, and maybe that might give us a priority for some educational and spread prevention messages at more of the regional scale. The stewards do ask other questions besides inspecting the boats and asking the boaters where they came from. They asked them if they took spread prevention measures. I think the real difference here, much higher percentages that yes, they did in 2008 than 2009. You know, I think everyone says yes. We kind of always have this discussion, you know, everyone says, oh, of course I did that, you know. But in 2008, when we said, did you take spread prevention measures, and they kind of had a blank face, I instructed the stewards to prompt them, like, to say, you know, like, did you wash your boat, drain your bilge, things like that, and then the people would say, oh, yes, yes. So in 2009, we told the stewards not to provide the prompts, to just ask if the people had taken spread prevention measures, you know, and if they didn't know what that meant, then chances were they hadn't done it. And so I think kind of really just the difference in the way we ask the question accounts for the different percentage of the response rate here. So I don't know that you could, you know, say that spread prevention went way down in 2009. That's not the takeaway message from this slide. It's really that how you ask the question affects the answer you get, so you need to be careful about that kind of thing. We collect all sorts of other data, too, about the recreational use. So we have information about the type of boat, whether it's an inboard or an outboard, all sorts of things like this. And so this we provide with the managers of the marinas. You know, it might help them manage the launch as well. So since we're there, we collect some other information as well. A number of things that we can learn from the steward program, the use trends, we can analyze and look at the number of boats by each day or by weekday. So we can see where the traffic is the heaviest in terms of prioritizing. For instance, it seems that Norwal and Mossy Point marinas have been the busiest marinas, so those are our priority launches for coverage because they have the most traffic coming through there. You can also figure out if you have to prioritize by day as well, which days are most busy. with Saturday being the busiest typically, and Sunday and Friday close to it. And then what surprises me is that Wednesday is busier than Thursday, and I have not come up with why that might be yet, but I keep trying to think of why that could be. But something about Wednesdays, I would have guessed Thursdays would have been next. The pathways, again, we already did that by looking at the map, seeing where the boats have been previously. And we can also look at that a little bit more with new species and the risks that might be introduced. I contacted colleagues in a number of different surrounding states in New Hampshire, Rhode Island, Maine, and I got from them some invasive species in some of the water bodies that we had listed that we had found that boats had been in previously coming to Lake George. So we had a number of species, such as Asian clam, Chinese mystery snail, things like this that weren't really on our radar here yet. But so we know now that there's actually a possible pathway between a water body infected with that species and our lake from a boat that came here. So you can really just learn a number of different things from the data that you collect. Besides actually sitting there at the launches and collecting data, we do try to give the stewards some other things to do. So they provide some educational outreach to the public at different events about invasive species and the work that they're doing at the launches. We have a water fest that was held in Ticonderoga. The stewards were there. They also helped man a display about invasive species during our Invasive Species Awareness Week. We have that display down at our Lake George Visitor Center. I have them meet with our fisheries biologist and learn about how invasive species can impact the Lake George fishery, and then they assist with salmon stocking in the lake as well as help Wayne Blanchard and staff from DEC in our region do garlic mustard poles and other terrestrial invasive plant removals at our campgrounds. One neat thing that we worked on last summer with the stewards was a rat guard for invasive species spread prevention for triathlons. We actually have two pretty large triathlons held in Lake George, and we got this idea from actually the Ironman held over in New Zealand. They had put together a lot of information and were very concerned about Didymo being spread on wetsuits over in New Zealand, and were actually requiring athletes to have their wetsuits decontaminated before participating in the event. We obviously weren't going to go that far, but what we did do was provide some information and actually set up a display up at the North Country Triathlon, which is in Hague, and I believe there were maybe around 200 participants in that. And then we actually had a contact with the Lake George Triathlon, which was over 400 participants, and our rat card, our information, was mailed out to all the participants ahead of time and was in their packet. So if anyone had been swimming in a nearby lake, possibly with their wetsuit, we wanted to make them aware of that as well. Really quickly, just to wrap things up, I just want to give you a typical feel for what a lake steward does. They have a nice table with some displays, a chair, a bucket that we give them to put everything in, and we've made some nice, just some folding signs that say lake steward on duty so people know that they are there and to expect them. We'll put them out usually kind of where the boats are pulling in so that the boaters can see that ahead of time. So they go out and they get set up in the morning. They work 8-hour days for Lake George. And then as soon as the boats arrive, they're off filling out their data sheets. This is what their data sheet looks like. It's a little overwhelming at first. We've tried to simplify it, but we're really trying to get a lot of information. So they fill out what the boat type is, the horsepower, the number of people in the group, and so on when they arrive and left, and just a number of things about did they inspect the boat, did they find anything, and things like that. So if anyone's interested in a copy of this sheet, I'm more than welcome to send out the file. It's just an Excel spreadsheet if anyone wants a copy of it to use on their lake. We also created a handout that we gave out that had about inspection checkpoints on one side and a little bit about zebra mussels and milfoil on the other. So the stewards handed this information out to every boater, as well as this trailer sticker. We use this to mark boats that had been inspected, so we asked people to actually put this on their trailer, and it would help identify them as being someone that had interacted with our lake stewards in the past. And this sticker was provided by Fish and Wildlife Services. and is being used across the country, I believe. So we're trying to keep a consistent message. Speaking about consistency, as I said before, we've been working closely within our PRISM here, the Basin Program over in Lake Champlain and Paul Smith, and down here at Lake George. And so we've actually gotten together and really thought about what might a regional program look like. So we have talked about a plan for centralized training and data management and oversight, and really taking all our individual programs and making them one regional program. There's no funding for this at this time. However, we have worked out the plan so that if funding does become available, you know, we can make this idea a reality. We presented as a group, the three programs, at the NOMS conference in Hartford last fall, and so I have some information here we compiled together. So Lake George is actually really the smallest launch program of the three in terms of boats inspected and people contacted. You can see that both Lake Champlain and the Paul Smith program, which covers 8 individual lakes, and Lake Champlain has 9 boat launch sites on their lake compared to our 5, they both inspected, almost 7,000 boats and contacted around 15,000 people. You can also see, though, of the organisms found, Lake Champlain found a lot more and had a higher percentage of invasives at their lake than the other two programs. In terms of what we found, again, Lake George and the Paul Smith program had a similar number of invasives, even though we had the fewer samples, so we had a higher percentage of invasives for our program, and then Lake Champlain just had a lot of samples. But then you can see over on the right-hand side the different species that were found. So we're really not finding that many species or that many different species on the boats right now. Lake Champlain found frog bit, which the other programs didn't have, and then variable leaf milfoil has now been determined to be invasive in the Adirondack Park, and so the Paul Smith program found a number of boats with that plant as well. Again, just a little bit about the coordination and working together. As I said before, we all do the training together. I think that photo's from last year. And so the dates for this year are going to be May 25th and 26th, which is a Tuesday and Wednesday. So everyone will have the stewards at their own program on Monday to introduce them to working at that lake. And then we'll travel to Paul Smith and then do group training for 2 days. And other lakes are invited to attend this training. I believe Saratoga Lake is joining us this year, and I'm not sure if anyone else is at this point or not, but you know, anyone else I'm sure is welcome to come. So if you are interested in that, please contact myself or Hillary or Eric or someone and let us know about that. And then we also at this training will get together because we try to collect the same data as well. So we at least have the same 5 main data points, such as, you know, the boat type, when it arrived, when it left, was there anything found on it, things like that. And then each of us might have some other different things that we do. For instance, for Lake George, we have a special Lake George decal that boats have to have, so we collect data on whether or not that is there, you know, whereas other lakes don't do that. So we try to coordinate at least kind of the same minimum data, because we hope one day maybe it could all be put in a regional database. And so if everyone has the same baseline, then we can combine all of the data. And we also are coordinating the outreach materials as well. So we're all using those boat trailer stickers that I showed earlier, the Stop Aquatic Hitchhikers, which is a federal campaign. These campaign materials are available to anyone. You just go on the website and join, and they will send you a CD with all of the illustration files for you to use in your publications. And we also just finished up a new handout for this summer. Paul Smith and the Basin Program were generous enough to pay to have a large number of these printed. So we are hoping to be able to provide them to some of the other lakes in our area that need information to hand out to their boaters. Again, just so we can have a consistent message that boaters are getting all throughout our area. Let's see. So real quick, just for Lake George, this season, we are actually going to have to scale back our program a little bit due to funding issues. I'm sure everyone is familiar with that. So we had to take a really hard look at our numbers and see where the boats were, what days of the week they were coming in, you know, where the invasive species were being found, and really prioritize some pretty scaled back efforts for this season. But we are going to have coverage at 3 launches. In years past, we have had coverage 5 days a week. And so this year, we're only going to be able to have the weekends or possibly a 3-day, a Friday, Saturday, Sunday week, which then, of course, you know, it's harder to find kids or college students, excuse me, that can only work for that many days a week. A lot of them need more work than that. So it is bringing some problems, but we're doing our best. And we ended up approaching the different towns around the lake for funding, and they are the ones that have finally come through for us. So the town of Hague has agreed to pay for a steward 2 days a week at their launch. The town of Bolton sent the request over to the Bolton LDC, their local development organization, and they have agreed to pay for a steward at Norwal Marina for 3 days. And we also really want to have a steward at Mossy Point for 3 days up in Ticonderoga. We don't have funding for that position yet, but we're still working on it, and I'm planning on hiring someone for there, so we're going to make it happen somehow. Money is an issue with these programs. I'm more than happy to share our budget, as I have here, even a more detailed breakdown to show people what it might cost to get one of these programs up and running on your own lake. The budget from last year is kind of a full-blown budget, with 5 stewards working full-time, 5 days a week, an assistant coordinator who stayed on way past the season, actually, and really wrote most of the report. He didn't have to leave, so he was able to keep working, so that really kind of increased that expense line there. But it was still a better use of his time than mine on that. You can see, you know, it can cost a fair bit to run one of these programs, but if you're really just trying to get something started up bare bones, you know, you can really just look at, you know, I just used $10 an hour as a good round number. We pay 9, actually, but the math's easier with 10. You think an 8-hour day. Then the biggest question really is how many days can you do? So if you think about the weekends from Memorial Day to Labor Day, that gives you 15. So that's 30 days. So you could staff a steward all summer at a launch on the weekends for $2,400. So this is really the proposal we went to the towns with, and they said, okay, you know, we'll give you the $2,400. So some of those other costs are going to come out of somewhere else. But so you can really kind of start bare bones like that and then work your way up. You know, well, what about 3 days a week? What about 4? What about, you know, 2 launches? And as you can see from the budget, there aren't that many other costs. I actually had shirts left over from last year. That's why I didn't have an expense for shirts. It is important for them to have a name tag, identifying them as a steward, to have a shirt, or say Lake Steward, in nice big print on the back. It is important to have them identified that way so that people kind of recognize them and they don't just kind of look like someone hanging out at the boat launch. But in general, you know, the specimen collection, you're talking Ziploc bags and, you know, little coolers and Sharpies and, you know, not very expensive stuff. So you really can get up and running pretty bare bones. And then it's just, you know, how much more you can do on top of that with how much funding you might have. And again, I'm more than happy to talk to anyone about expenses in more detail later. So really just kind of the take-home message, I think, from all of this is that the stewards, they really are out there every day talking to these boaters. You know, it's a tough job to interact with some of these people sometimes. And they really are the front line of spread prevention. And I think these lake steward programs are extremely important in terms of, you know, dealing with aquatic invasive species. I think we've all heard, you know, the saying an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure, and I think that is, you know, very true in this case. You do have to think about some things about what the goal of your program is. Is it really, you know, kind of what we call the save, the numbers, saying, oh, you know, we stopped, you know, 50 bits of milfoil from coming in our lake? Or is it really that long-term behavioral change of people cleaning their boats on their own and not transporting these things? And I think it's both. I think obviously the first one is, you know, something that you can point to right away. It's that kind of short-term goal that you can reach. With the behavioral change, that long-term goal being much harder to actually, you know, figure out if we're being successful there, even though that really is our eventual goal. And also really just that no matter what it is, don't move it. A lot of people say, oh, how am I supposed to identify that? You know, and you don't want to overwhelm them. So if you just keep the message simple, that, you know, you just don't want to move anything, I think that helps a lot of the time. And then just finally, that really through working together and through regional collaborations such as the one we're working on up here and maybe some other ones going on out there, that, you know, a number of these smaller programs can really kind of have a bigger impact on the regional scale by working together. And especially as funding is going to be tighter and tighter these days, I think it's more and more important for us to all work together and share resources to make the biggest impact that we can. So I think that is it.